really good to be with you. Glad that you're here. If we haven't had a chance to meet yet, my name is John, and some of you weren't here last week, and you're back after some summer gigs or whatever, and I was gone for a little bit and got to be away for about 12 weeks with my family on a sabbatical, so it's good to kind of be back, and I used up a lot of words last week, but I actually think I came with more words this week, so we're just going to go for it. We just jumped into this teaching series really on Jesus' longest recorded teaching that we have inside the scriptures. And really what Jesus is doing is really addressing a very like first century set of issues that maybe sometimes shockingly are also a very like 2023 set of issues. It's amazing how timeless Jesus' words really can be. And inside of all of it, what he's really inviting us to do is to live something, to experience something, to know something, but then do something that's different. He's giving us a very different invitation than the world is giving us, and he was giving his first hearers a very different invitation than the world and the systems around them were giving them in the time. So this teaching is recorded Matthew chapter 5 through chapter 7, New Testament, your Bible. If you've got a Bible, I want to invite you to open today to Matthew chapter 5. Matthew chapter 5 is where we're going to be today. Last week, we started, like we took a beginning point, but we took the end as the beginning point. We said, let's go all the way to the end, because we find this little summary that Jesus says. And what he really says then, chapter 7, is he says, hey, I'm going to give all people a choice, and you, what I really want to invite you to do is hear everything that I'm saying, and I want you to like take my words, and this is the invitation, I want you to build your life on it, and that'll be like putting your life on a rock. That'd be like building your life on this really firm, stable, very sure and anchored foundation. Now, the alternative is you can build your life on things I don't say, and you get to choose that, and that's like building your life on sand. It may hold up for a while. It may look good for a while. All the surface things look really good, but when storms come, the rock does better at weathering the storm. When the storm comes, if you built on sand, you're going to have to replace something. Parts of it are going to break down, and sometimes the whole of it breaks down. It's honestly why some of us feel like we live life in cycles all the time, where we're constantly experiencing the same problems over and over and over and over again, because we're looking for solutions built on sand. And Jesus says, man, I know that I hate seeing you live like that. That just grieves me to see you live like that. So I want to invite you to come and live, build your life, build the way you live, build your thinking, all of that. Just build it on what I say. So Jesus finished this kind of lengthy teaching of his by saying that, take all the things I've said and like build your life around those. Grab a hold of these principles, these ways, these thoughts, these actions. And inside of that, what Jesus is really doing is giving the people that are listening to him this really big invitation. Like, hey, like, come on. Like, I want to invite you to live in a kingdom, in a way. A kingdom is just a way of life, right? It has a king and the king has a way. And Jesus says, come into my kingdom. I've got a different way of life for you. At the end of the day, it's actually going to be really fulfilling. It's going to be better for you. All the roads you're traveling now that are different than that, they really do lead to harm and some disappointment, destruction. They lead to eternity without me. So, like, come over here, build your life on this rock of my teaching. I really have a good thing for you. Not necessarily a perfect and easy thing, but a good thing. A good thing. Your life won't be flawless. Your life won't be without storm. Storm comes on both sand and rock, but you'll be able to withstand some storms. So we're going to go back to the beginning today. Matthew chapter 5 is where we're going to start that. So if you've got a Bible or you flipped a phone or whatever it is you've got, that's great. Matthew chapter 5, very beginning, verse 1. This is Matthew writing to some of his Jewish friends and Jewish communities later, trying to help them see Jesus for who he really was as this savior of theirs, this king that really they'd been looking for but had missed a lot of them. Matthew writes this, that seeing the crowds, Jesus went up on the mountain, and when he sat down, his disciples came to him. And it's initial, like his initial disciples, these closest followers. And then there's all these other people that are listening to and following. Like, it's this really big crowd that comes up. And then verse 2, it says this, and he opened his mouth and he taught them. And this is where we get the beginning of the teaching. For the next few chapters, we get all these words of Jesus covering all of these different themes and all these different topics. And he says it into this kind of culture. He says it into a culture that has all sorts of political turmoil and divisiveness. the Jews live under the hand of Rome, and it can be peaceful as long as the Jews do everything that the Romans want, right? Including pay taxes to them and all those kind of things, right? Treat Caesar like God, all those kind of things. It's politically divisive. It's not great. But it's also really religiously tense. There's a lot of religious battle and infighting and confusion and vying for power. It's really kind of this messed up thing. And Jesus walks into that. And in these three chapters that we have recorded in Matthew, Jesus says, I want to give you something different than both of those. I want to give you something that's completely different than both of those. And again, it's still true for us. Like, I mean, it's easy, right? I mean, here we are. What are we doing? Like, we're praying for Israel. We're praying for innocent civilians. We're praying for world turmoil, right? The world is chaotic right now. It is a storm. It is a raging storm. And it's a little religiously tense around the world. There are religious undertones to so much of what's happening and so much of what we deal with and so much of what is happening around the world. And there's like this vying that this is the right way to see God. No, this is the right way to see God. Right? And Jesus comes in the middle of that and he says, look, I am God. I'm the Son of the living God. Look right here. Look at me. And I want to show you this way. And that's what he begins to talk about. So let's just pick up his teaching. We'll pick up verse 3. When you say verse 3, say, I see it. Let's try one more time. When you say verse 3, say, I see it. Even if you had to cheat and wait for a screen, that was okay, right? Okay, before we read this, I want you to do me a favor. Everybody grab a phone real quick. Grab your phone, okay? This is the only time the pastor's ever going to say this in church, okay? Grab your phone real quick. I know some of you already have it. If you put it away, or if you were too spiritual and you left yours in the car, just nestle into somebody who has their phone with them, okay? And here's what I want you to do. I'm not going to ask you to share this or do anything with it or anything like that, but will you just real quickly take a selfie? Just take a selfie, okay? Take a selfie. If you're with somebody who doesn't have theirs, lean in so it can be an usie, okay? But you got to just get a little selfie there, okay? Did y'all get it? Y'all get it? Okay, just hold that. We'll come back to that, okay? Yeah, we'll come back to that. This is what Jesus says. He says, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. See, what Jesus is going to do is he's going to paint this picture of what a blessed life really is, and he uses a word that they would have used in the culture, like kind of in this Aramaic language, that would have stood for the Isle of Happy. And it was this Isle of Cyprus that they viewed as the perfect place. You could live deeply satisfied, content, have everything provided for you on this Isle of Cyprus, and you would never have to leave its coast. And Jesus says, I'm going to invite you into something bigger. That's a neat goal. That's a neat retirement goal. But I'm going to invite you into something different. And he says this word over and over and over in the early, blessed, 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 blessed. Your life can be like this Isle of Happy. Your life can have this like enduring, everlasting joy. This is what Jesus is inviting people into. Jesus, in these next few lines, isn't giving a list of like, hey, do it this way. Jesus isn't giving a list of rules. He's giving an invitation to attitudes. Jesus is giving an invitation to different attitudes than everybody's being invited to by the political system of the day, by the religious system of the day, by the socioeconomic system of the day. He's like, hey, no, like, I want to invite you to different attitudes. And attitudes really, like, attitudes are really simple things, so just we're all on the same page. Attitudes are like when we have a belief or a thought and we hold it so deeply that it shows up in our behaviors. Like, it shows up in our behaviors. And you all, like, we all know people with, like, who have bad attitudes. Right? We've all been people with bad attitudes, right? You're like, oh, you don't want to be around him when he gets like that, okay? Oh, you don't want to, don't say that to her. You don't want that wrath, okay? Right? I mean, we know what an attitude is, right? There's something so deeply held that it affects our attitudes. And Jesus is saying, hey, I want to invite you into some attitudes that are out of a whole different kingdom. And if you'll embrace these, like if you'll say yes to the invitation, you could live this blessed life regardless of when the storms are coming. You could build your life on this rock of me and who I am. And you could endure these storms very differently. So he says this at the beginning, like, blessed, go back to verse 3, blessed is the one who's like poor in spirit, right? Blessed is the poor in spirit. You saw it, right? What's that idea of poor in spirit? Poor in spirit, really, it's an attempt to get to the word humble, but it's a little more nuanced and rich than that. It's really what Jesus is saying, man, is blessed is the person who has this really healthy self-assessment. Blessed, like, I'm inviting you to be a person who has this really healthy self-assessment and self-awareness. Okay, just now grab your selfie here real quick. Look at your selfie. Okay, I got mine. I literally did. I followed the rules. Okay, look. You got your selfie, like, just look at it for a second. And just think for a second. How do you view you? How do you view you? You're like, I don't like to look at myself. I don't like. Yeah, you do. Every single one of us, when we're in a picture that's a group of people, who do we look for first? Ourselves, right? Don't lack. Yes, you do. Yes, you do. And then you act all embarrassed. Oh, I look terrible. Yeah, but you look for yourself first, okay? We like to look at it. Okay, it's okay. But what do you see? How would you assess you? Here's the challenge. We're not very good at self-assessment. We're not very good. We have a tendency to play to one of two extremes because in our human nature, in this part of us that sometimes pushes against and wants to live in independence from God. In this human nature, we often assess ourselves a little too highly or a little too low. We think a little more of ourselves, or we try and think a little more of ourselves to prop up some confidence and prop up some security and prop up some momentum, or we're constantly minimizing and disqualifying ourselves and breaking ourselves down and saying, oh, I'm not good enough for that, or I don't look good enough for that, I can't do that, I don't have talent for that, right? And it's usually a little more subtle than this, but it's, I'm God's gift to the world, or at least all the people who are fortunate enough to be in my sphere of life. Or, man, I'm not worth being around anybody. We're often not real great at self-assessment. Again, those are the extremes. We're often, you know, a lot towards the middle. Part of what Jesus is getting at here, hey, if you want to, like, you want to get a really healthy self-assessment, what if you would let me be the one that assesses you? What if you would see me and then let me see you? What if you would see you the way I see you? Just look back at your selfie here for a second. Last time, okay? It's also just a good chance for me to drop in. It's a great time to silence your phones and all those kind of things. Okay. What do you think? I mean, God sees. What do you think? What do you think he thinks when he looks at you? What do you think Jesus thinks when he looks at you? Go one step further. What do you think Jesus feels when he looks at you? What do you think internally Jesus feels when he looks at you? Can I tell you some things it's not? He doesn't feel shame. He's not ashamed of you. He's not embarrassed of you. He's not riddled with disappointment. Is there disappointment and hurt in Jesus at times because of us? Yeah, we do hurt him. He does have the capacity to hurt. We do hurt him when we push against his love, when we resist it, when we live independently of it. But what if when Jesus looked at you, what if you could first come to grips with the fact that he's deeply enthused about your life? That he's proud of his own creation in you. That regardless of what your parent or your spouse or people at school or on your team or in your work environment have said, he takes great joy in being with you. There's this passage in the Psalms that says, in the presence of God, there is fullness of joy. Do you know what that means? That means fullness of joy for both parties. That's you and God. There's something about being with you. There's something about being with you that activates God's joy. How crazy is that? Jesus says, man, you want to be blessed. I want to invite you to just build your house over here on this rock. And part of the way you do that is if I could just give you this really healthy self-assessment. And the way to do that is I want to just invite you to take my view of you instead of your view of you. I want to invite you to let your view be shaped by my view. Listen, lean in here with me for a second. Listen. We know tons of things about God. Most of us don't need another fact about God for the rest of our life. But what we do need is an experience with God that takes all those things we know about God and lets the totality of our life be shaped by them. What do you think Jesus thinks and feels when he looks at you? And for some of us, if we're really honest, for some of us, the starting point isn't what does Jesus think or feel when he looks at me. It's actually one step before that, and it's to say, I just need to let him convince me that he's actually looking at me to begin with. Even with my sin and my rebellion, even in my addiction, even in all of my successes, some of which I've claimed as my own and not having anything to do with him, he's still looking at me. I think it's interesting that Jesus starts with that. The longest recorded teaching of Jesus we're going to get, he starts with, hey man, if you want to be blessed, if you want to live in this place of depth of satisfaction, let's get to the point where we've got a healthy assessment of ourselves. And you're not solely in charge of developing the healthy assessment. You get to receive my view of you, my feeling towards you. And then Jesus goes on a little bit and he keeps rolling. Let's just look at the next three lines that Jesus says. Blessed are those who mourn, because they will be comforted. And blessed are the meek, for they're going to inherit the earth. And blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they're going to be deeply satisfied. These three little verses, these three lines here of Jesus, what Jesus is really getting at is look, I want to invite you to a new attitude that if you would build your life on this, there is a blessed, happy, joyful condition in it, even when storms are going on all around you. He says, what I really want to invite you into is this new attitude towards sin. You need a new attitude towards yourself. You got to see you how I see you. But I want to invite you into a new attitude towards sin. This word mourn, there's all sorts of words for mourn and grief in the New Testament. This one in particular is directly and always related to sin. It's always related to sin. Jesus isn't talking about when we mourn the loss of a loved one, which all of us experience, when we mourn the loss of an opportunity, which we all experience, when we mourn the loss of all of us. What Jesus is saying, hey, look, I want to talk specifically. I want to tell you that if you could have a different attitude towards sin and build your life on this, if you would actually grieve that, you can know comfort. You can know comfort. You can know my comfort. You can know my compassion and my grace. You don't ever have to live with this shame and this unrelenting guilt and this condemnation that says, well, that's it. Your life can't count for anything now. That was the end. She's like, no. Just like actually grieve that. And there is this like new attitude towards sin that he invites us into. And again, we tend to play the extremes, and the people of Jesus, they were doing it too. One extreme is, like, my sin disqualifies me for everything forever. There's no way. God's got grace for all those people. He couldn't have grace for me. God's got grace for that addict. He couldn't possibly have grace and transformation for me. God's got grace for that selfish. It couldn't possibly be true for me. Or we play the other extreme that just says, I mean, it doesn't really matter. I mean, the ways of Jesus are a little outdated and irrelevant anyway. It doesn't really, like, it's just not that big of a deal. And Jesus is like, actually, neither one of those are true. Those are like the invitations of the day, but I want to give you an invitation to a different kingdom where we acknowledge it and we actually grieve it. We mourn it. We deeply grieve it, which means we have to see it for what it is. I came across this prayer. It's a prayer from a couple hundred years ago written by a guy, and I just want to read you like one line from this prayer. It's stuck with me for months now. It says this, come blessed spirit. It's just this written prayer of this guy. It says, come blessed spirit, author of all grace and consolation. And then this line, it's been good for me. Show me my sin in all of its worst colors. That I may feel an unwavering hatred of it. Sin does this really good job of making you hate you, but the invitation of God is that sin would make you hate it. Sin is what's ugly. And when we hate it, can I tell you what we do when we hate it? When we hate it, we will repent. We will turn. When we see it as ugly and destructive as it is, when we see it in all of its worst colors, we will repent. We will make the turn. It's this new attitude towards Jesus. And here's what happens. Jesus like builds on things a little bit here. Then that next line, he says, like, and you're going to be blessed if you're meek, right? If you'd be meek. And a lot of times we think of like meek. Well, that must mean I'm supposed to be weak. And especially in a world of turmoil, how is it that I'm supposed to be weak and defend myself and all those kind of things? It's nothing what Jesus talked about. What Jesus talked about when he talked about meek is, hey, when you're meek, you actually are power under control. Meekness is power, but it's under control. See, sin is power with no control. Sin is power with no control, no ability to say no to it, no willingness to say no, no submission to Jesus and his way. Sin is, I have the power and I get to control it. When we see it in all its ugly colors, and when we really mourn over it, when we really grieve it, and we become repentant of it, all of a sudden what begins to happen is Jesus begins to shape in us. We begin to like surrender to his control in it, and then we still have this power, but it's under control. It's under his leadership, and our passions get expressed in the environments they were created to be expressed in, and our voice gets conveyed in the ways and the environments it was meant to be conveyed in, and our love gets expressed with the power and the force it was meant to be expressed with. And our deepest desires, our deepest longings get expressed in the way they were meant. And sexual sin goes from addictions and vices and grips to being inside this context of marriage that Jesus designed it to be in. Why? Because it becomes power under control. That's make Jesus like, man, if you'll see it as ugly, whoo, if you'll see it as ugly and you build your life on that, if you don't see it as like making, just calling you ugly, if you won't see yourself as ugly, and if you won't just belittle it and act like it doesn't matter and I can do anything I want, like if you would actually trust that I have a good thing, and I'm inviting you into a good thing, and you would build your life on that, then whoa, whoa. Just imagine your life with power under control. And not reckless, selfish, destructive, unbridled power. Think about a horse, right? You get a horse and it hasn't been tamed and it's wild and it's strong and it's powerful. It could damage, it could hurt, right? And then you think about the horse once it's trained, right? It still has all the same power. It's just under control. It's under control. It's got these parameters. It understands how to operate and interact. Jesus, I want to invite you to a different attitude towards yourself. And I would just love to help you see my attitude towards you. And I want to invite you to a different attitude towards sin, because if you could see you and have an attitude towards yourself like I do, I think you'll see sin as more ugly anyway, because when you see you like I do in this, the way I see you as a treasure and the way I see you as somebody built and created for a really holy, wild adventure, that then you'll actually see sin that dilutes that. It's really destructive and ugly like it really is. And you'll see sin is something like, oh, I don't have to create my own like life adventure and wonder. I don't have to create my own significance. I already have this Jesus that sees me with all of this and views me with all. If I have his attitude towards that, I'm much more likely to have his attitude towards sin. Jesus, come on, like let me just invite you to this. I'm not going to make you. It's your choice. You can build on sand, but I want to invite you to a rock. And when storms rage and sin hasn't had a destructive pattern going on below the surface of your life, you're more apt to withstand this. When the storm rages and you see that regardless of weather condition of your life or the world, you understand and you have your attitude towards you is shaped by my attitude towards you, you're just going to be a lot more stable. You have a lot more security in that. Here's the thing. Jesus got several more blessed to go. And I was even going to tell you about four attitudes. I told you about two. We're going to call it good. I think we got to respond to some things. I think we need a window of time to just respond a little bit and say, What would I do with that? Would I, in a very medicinal, holy way, let my attitude toward myself be shaped and molded and guided by the attitude Jesus has towards me? Would I say yes to that invitation? Would I give Jesus some space to help me see how ugly and destructive sin is? And the reason it's ugly and destructive is because its destruction is bent on me, and he loves me. Maybe even today we would see it as ugly. We would see it not as, we would see sin not as it's the final victor in our life, but we would see it as a defeated, ugly enemy. And we would repent. We would make some turns. Say, I don't want that anymore. I'm not doing that. I don't want that anymore. With the help of Jesus, I'm not doing that anymore.